Almost 2 years into this pandemic, there is much we know about COVID-19. We know it's killed more than 5 million people. It's shut down countries and economies across the globe. It's reordered sector after sector and the lives of billions of people. What we don't know with sufficient certainty, however, is where did it come from? Author Elaine Dewar takes that on in her riveting new book. It's called On the Origin of the Deadliest Pandemic in 100 Years, An Investigation. And it brings Elaine Dewar to our airwaves from Midtown in Ontario's capital city. Elaine, it's good to see you again. How are you doing?
I'm fine. Nice to see you.
Glad to have you aboard. I guess people know there's sort of two basic theories about how, and let's call it by its technical name here, SARS-CoV-2, the virus that causes COVID-19, how it got to infect humans. There's the wet market theory, and there's the lab leak theory. Now, the lab, in this case, is the Wuhan Institute of Virology, and your book argues for why the lab theory is the more likely account. So we will get there, but just for kicks off the top, why don't you give us the wet market theory just so we understand what that is, and then we'll move on.
I need to correct you. The wet market theory was taken off the table in the first month of the pandemic. It is clear from the epidemiology that was published by the Chinese experts in Nature, the Lancet, New England Journal of Medicine, that about 44% of the earliest victims had no connection whatsoever to the wet market. So it wasn't a wet market. The question really becomes nature versus lab. And similarly, while most of us have sort of zeroed in on the Wuhan Institute of Virology, which has the largest collection of coronaviruses anywhere in the world, as the possible source of a lab leak, there was another lab in Wuhan called the Wuhan Center for Disease Control and Prevention, where there were also considerable numbers of studies on bats pulled in from caves all over China, specifically from the south, which we know actually moved on the 1st of December. And we know that one of the people in that lab got sick. So it's possible that it's one of two labs, and it's also possible that it's nature alone.
Is there a piece of evidence, one in particular, that as you were accumulating your research and evidence for this book, that you thought to yourself, that's the thing that really makes me believe that it's the lab leak?
Yeah. And that is that from the very beginning, it was so perfectly adapted to human beings. If there had been a spillover, which is the sort of technical term that's used by virologists, from a bat or an intermediate animal like a pangolin or some other animal before it infected humans, there should have been a period in which the virus had a rough time adapting itself to human beings. But what all of the epidemiology of the first months of the pandemic shows is that there was almost no mutation, which is what happens when a virus gets into a new host. It evolves quickly, it mutates rapidly in order to adapt itself to where it finds itself. That kind of adaptation did not really happen for at least the first quarter of the circulation of SARS-CoV-2. So the question has to be asked, where and how did it become so perfectly adapted to human beings? And that really points more to a lab leak than to a natural spillover.
And just to be clear about this, you are not alleging that the Chinese somehow nefariously developed this as a kind of a bioweapon, right?
I am not saying anything of that nature. I think it's very clear that the Chinese military and the Chinese civilian researchers work together, but it is not at all clear that the Chinese researchers who seem to have been working in the Wuhan Institute of Virology, for example, were working there on a bioweapon. It's, I think, a much more reasonable assumption that a very interesting virus was being experimented on by leading virologists in one of two labs. And somebody made a mistake, and somebody walked out of that lab who may have had asymptomatic infection, and boom.
Experimented on for what purpose, do you suppose?
Well, the purpose that's given in most of the scientific papers I read is that if we can somehow predict a spillover of a nasty virus before it happens, then perhaps we can have vaccines prepared in advance. Perhaps we can prevent exactly what we've been living through for the past 2 years. So the question becomes, how do you do that? And the answer that has come out of various virology labs since basically 2011, actually a little bit earlier, is that we can manipulate and change those parts of a virus which attacked to a host cell. And by changing them, perhaps predict what nature might do in a bat where many viruses circulate at the same time and often recombine and create new and perhaps more dangerous viruses. So the point of the lab work is to get ahead of nature. The fact is that it's failed utterly. We've never managed to get ahead of nature.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's dive a little deeper here. And to that end, I want to put a technical term on the table here. Have you describe briefly what it means, and then we'll go from there. Gain of function research. What is gain of function research?
It means that you are taking a virus into a lab, that you are either trying to make it infect a new host, or you're trying to make it more lethal, or you're trying to make it more infectious.
And is gain of function research a significant part of the explanation which leads you to the lab leak theory?
Yes and no.
Okay.
Yes, in that it is clear that gain of function research is being done in various labs in the United States, in China, even in this country, and has been done for quite some time. It is also clear that specifically SARS-like coronaviruses have been subjected to gain-of-function experiments at the Wuhan Institute of Virology for quite some time, and in concert with American colleagues and with American funding. So gain-of-function research is done with the purpose of trying to figure out what nature might do, and as I said before, we haven't managed to get ahead of nature in that regard.
Right. But what you just said, the fact that the U.S., and let me just check here, yes, it was the National Institute of Health, the fact that the National Institute of Health was funding this research...
In China.
In China, right, has added, you know, well, I don't have to tell you, it's added all sorts of nuances and conspiracy theories as to why the Americans were funding it. So maybe you could tell us, in your view, why they were.
Well, two things. There has been ever since the SARS pandemic of 2003, there has been an attempt for virologists around the world to work, especially with Chinese virologists, which is deemed to be a hot spot for the evolution of viruses which may spill over to us. So a globalized virological science has taken off since basically 2004, 2005. And the other question is this. If you are, for example, the Defense Department in the U.S., and you're worried about dual-use research of concern, in other words, research on viruses that might be used as weapons, not simply to create vaccines, you would like to have people on the ground in China and in other places which may not be close friends to the United States, to make sure you understand what's going on in those labs. So there were two reasons for the funding. One was the nice globalized virology is good for all, and the other is the not so nice, beware what your not so close friends are doing.
But from the moment the pandemic struck, the lab leak theory was out there, but there seemed to be, I don't know, I don't want to overstate this, but there seemed to be a sort of a concerted effort among official channels in the United States to denounce it as a kind of a byproduct of conspiratorial thinking. Why was there so much hesitation to take it seriously for so long?
It wasn't a hesitation. It was a flat-out attempt to protect interests. One of the things that we haven't discussed is how money moved from the United States, from the NIH, from USAID, from the Department of Defense, from the Department of Homeland Security, to various labs around the world, especially the Wuhan Institute of Virology. And the answer is through a charity called Echo Health Alliance. That got rid of the direct responsibility for the NIH or the NIAID to really look carefully at the kind of work being done in labs in China. They obviously had no access. The access was through the CEO of a charity, Peter Daszak, who theoretically was in charge of reporting accurately on what was being done in the Wuhan lab. But as we saw over the last 2 years, we were not getting good reports. The NIAID had a grant out that they actually stopped under Trump, and which reporting was really not up to date. I mean, the reporting that was required specifically on gain of function experiments was almost 2 years late.
I should just, because we hate acronyms here, so NIAID is the National Institute of Allergy and Infectious Diseases.
You got congratulations.
It. And that's yeah. Anthony Fauci's operation. And of course, he's the top advisor to the president right now in all of this. What role have you been able to find that Anthony Fauci played in all of what you've been describing here so far?
Well, what's so interesting is on January 31st, Dr. Fauci got an email followed up by a phone call from a fellow named Christian Anderson, who is at the Scripps and is a leading virologist, and his colleague E.C. Holmes, who is at University of Sydney and the University of Fudan in China, to say, Dr. Fauci, we've had a look at the genome sequence that's been published, and we think there may have been manipulation or engineering going on in that sequence. So emergency meeting followed, and at that emergency meeting the next day was Dr. Fauci, Dr. Collins, I think a fellow from named Farrar from the Wellcome Trust in the UK, as well as Christian Anderson, Dr. Holmes, etc. And within 2 days of that meeting, there was a concerted series of letter-writing campaigns set off. The letters mainly drafted by Peter Daszak of Echo Health Alliance, but also contributed to by Christian Anderson, Ralph S. Barrick, Linfa Wang, all people who had worked closely with Xi Zhengli, the so-called Batwoman of China, whose lab was doing the interesting experiments at the Wuhan Institute of Virology. And all of those letters, one that to appear in The Lancet, another that was sent to the White House on the letterhead of the National Academies of Sciences, Medicine, and Engineering, all said, don't even think about lab leak. It's a conspiracy theory, and it's wrong.
And has Fauci's view on that evolved at all over time?
It has indeed. In May of this year, there was what you could call a flip turn in the official positions of Americans with interest in this question. And Dr. Fauci was one of those who flipped. He went from saying lab leak, not possible, to saying it needs to be properly investigated. Ralph Barrick was another one who flipped. He signed a letter to Science saying, you know, I know what I was saying before, but what I'm saying now is we'd have to do a proper investigation, and no proper investigation has been done. So, yes, Dr. Collins also flipped, I mean, and has left the NIH. The change came very rapidly. But as a result of a really interesting paper by a guy named Nicholas Wade, who wrote just a blistering article in the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists in the early part of May, which laid out the argument for a lab leak and laid out the interests that had been protecting themselves, shall we say, since the onset of the pandemic.
How concerned are you? I want to ask you about you now. How concerned are you that you have a kind of predisposed instinctive bias towards the lab leak theory away from other theories?
I was very concerned about that as I worked through. I think most journalists know when they examine their souls that they start from a position when they enter a story, and it is a dangerous thing for journalists not to really self-examine over and over and over again to make sure that they haven't given vent to their own predilection as opposed to what the facts present. I think at the end of the day, after working myself over and over and over, I've come to a conclusion that I can stand behind, which is I think it is clear as a bell that the best argument we have, the best set of facts we have, the behavior of China to suppress those facts points to a lab leak.
Is there any reason to believe that the Chinese may at some point be more open to having the international community help in China with an investigation into all of this?
I think there's not a chance in hell.
Not a chance in hell. And just to circle back, I take it that part of the reason that you may have had this bias instinctively towards the lab leak theory is that we all prefer to believe that we did something wrong to make this happen, as opposed to we're living in a world where Mother Nature can randomly exercise her will against us.
Exactly. And look at the disaster that Mother Nature can inflict. So, yes, there is something about the notion that humans did this that is both satisfying and soothing in a weird sort of way. But I think at the end of the day, because we have been unable to find any animal which has anything like a SARS-CoV-2 ancestor circulating in it, in spite of all of the work that was done by the WHO convened joint study committee on the China side to look at animals who might have had such infections, and in spite of what they did not do to look at whether or not there had been a problem in a lab, I think at the end of the day, we may end up looking more closely at the lab leak, and we may at the end of the day begin to understand how dangerous gain-of-function experiments are and how unregulated they are, and move to do something about that.
Well, if we've heard it once, we've heard it 1,000 times, and that is the admonition by both politicians and scientists to quote-unquote follow the science. Based on your having now written this book, what do you think of the advisability of doing that?
Science is a debate. It's an argument. It changes. It unfolds. It takes time. So to stand on the position that you are following the science as a politician is difficult, because the science can be in many directions at once. It's not simple.
Mm-hmm. I want to ask you one more personal question, if I may, and that is, how did your maternal grandmother die?
My maternal grandmother died in the great flu pandemic of 1918-1919.
She died of the Spanish flu.
She did. She died one day before my mother's first birthday. And it was a big secret in my mother's family until my mother was 14 that she thought her stepmother was her real mother until she was 14 years old.
I really don't mean this to be a flippant question, but here you are a century later, you know, spending a great deal of your personal currency looking into the great pandemic of this generation, of your generation. Is this in some respects the family business?
I guess. You know, my dad was a doctor. I remember driving around in the car with him when I was about 4 or 5 years old during the polio pandemic. I mean, the only time we got to see my dad was when he took us for car rides to see his patients. So, there is a personal matter here. And in fact, we buried my mother, who was 102 years old, just as the pandemic began to circulate in Wuhan. So, story meant for me.
Understood. Elaine Dewar, latest book on the origin of the deadliest pandemic in 100 years, an investigation. We thank you for joining us on TVO tonight, Elaine. Be well.
Thank you for having me.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.